black people. It's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving.
Warning. Stand by for countdown. Prepare audience for maximum impact. Full immersion begins in.
It's your glory. Just keep it going.
Black people too try to suppress our determination to achieve liberation. Like Angela Davis said, it's built into the system.
Nowadays I can't believe what's going on in front of me. I don't want to watch TV and find another casualty. I don't want to read the news. My heart's already black and blue. I'm putting on my combat boots, 'cause I got an attitude. We're like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done. And don't you even ask me, when did I become such an angry black woman?
We can't successfully put an end to racial discrimination until we change the entire system.
We've been trying to keep the peace 50 years since Martin King. Some don't like me for who I am, but I love my melanin. Another future college grad sleeping in a body bag. Mother screaming out her lungs, she never gonna see her son. We like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done.
It's not right. Just keep it going.
They see something that I don't see. What can you learn from a bum, Omar? Shamsuddin? What I learned from a bum, maybe it's what not to do.
No Nobody takes down Angel Snuff Nuff 7 easy. There's a reason why, after 100 channels destroyed, Angel Snuff Nuff 7 is still here. There's a reason why nobody want to get in a beef with Angel Snuff Nuff 7. But you don't take me seriously.
This is a story about control. My control. Control of what I say and control of what I do. And this time I'm gonna do it my way. I hope you enjoy this as much as I do. Are we ready? I am. 'Cause it's all about control. And I've got lots of it.
Love, and I've learned. I've learned
a heart is a house.
You got to feel it.
Back to life, back to reality, back to life, back to reality.
Lie to me, your eyes were talking. it's enough to drive me wild, and I cannot take much more of it. Oh.
Tell me the secret we're sharing. What is on your mind?
Tell me the secret way.
Tell me the secret we're sharing. I will tell you mine.
Yes, I'd like to talk to you. Take some of your precious time. I'd like to get to know you. Would you be so kind and do?
Tell me your secret wish and what is on your mind.
Tell me your secret wish.
Tell me your secret wish and I will tell you mine.
Whatever you want and whatever you need, I will give. Stars above, if you'd only talk to me.
Tell me your secret way.
Tell me your secret way. Thoughts you cannot pretend with me. I can feel the thunder, I can hear your heartbeat. Come a little closer to me, don't be afraid, I will not bite. I'm not such a bad girl, I'm only longing for the night.
Tell me your secret wish and what is on your mind. Tell me your secret wish and I will tell you mine. Tell me your secret wish and what is on your mind. Tell me your secret wish and I will tell you mine.
And
even in religion itself, it says that we are the children of God. Children can't stay children forever. Children must become adults. So if we are the children of God, that means we become God. Act like God, move like God, and have the responsibility of a God. Dragon Manifest. Welcome to the Reality Strip on Earth, Dragon Manifest.
Thank you for having me, brother. This is an honor. When I first saw your channel, I said, oh, this is an ancestor that has most definitely returned. Yes, most definitely. This is not a new ancestor. This is an old ancestor. you could feel the ancestors through you. You know, most people probably say, what is he talking about?
Right.
They don't get it. You gotta be on that level.
If you say that I'm divine and I'm a prophet, where the hell did your ass go to? Why aren't you heeding the call? Since I'm a prophet, since I'm divine. Some people, excuse the language, some people just like talking out their ass. 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 That's what they like to do.
He's forever and always. My black people, it's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving.
Try to debate anger stuff. There are many people, they want to debate and get angry at me. You can't debate me. You're cutting pace.
Show me the way to the future. Cause I am tired of the past. Some of us are just used to resisting. We all know.
The Reality Temple on Earth.
Shout out to the Reality Temple on Earth on IG.
We love watching it.
Yeah, we really do.
We send love, peace, and soul.
Good evening, soul brothers and sisters. This is Tanji Cox, the Black Sheep, and I am propositioning you to entertain just a little while of being in reality. And this is gonna hurt soul sisters and brothers, because a lot of us cannot accept reality. I empower you to, for 1 year, to subscribe to the Reality Temple on Earth. And at the end of 12 months, draw your conclusion of what have you learned in that amount of time. I empower you. You will never, ever, ever think, feel, or entertain nonsense ever again, period. I would like to see my soul sisters and brothers awaken. This requires time. You need to spend about a year watching, researching, and looking. Reality Temple on Earth is life-changing, and I stand on that.
The Deacons of Reality put out a short video and talk about winning. I don't like losing. I really don't. I'm very competitive. I don't like losing. Some people don't mind losing. Oh, it ain't nothing but a game. I don't like losing. I really don't. I'm very competitive. I don't like losing. Some people don't mind losing. Oh, it ain't nothing but a game. Because you're a loser. Of course it's nothing but a game, because you're a loser. Anybody that play any game, you play the game because you want to win. Nobody plays a game to be a loser. Nobody.
And the cow was returned to its rightful owner.
Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started.
Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride.
Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started.
Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride.
Let's get this party started quickly.
Quickly, quickly, quickly.
Bring your mind.
Sherry, it's so good to see you. Thanks for dropping in. Transformation, bless up. Bless up. Thank you for that. Let's see. Talik says, can you send a shout out to my platform, the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry? Our theme this year is After Purge Comes the Heal. Stuff. Shout out to your platform, Talik. All the best to you guys with continuing to stretch in perspective, to stretch in what is possible, and to continue to bring healing into the space of yourself and others. Yes.
The game begins in 3, 2, 1.
Day in 1995. Welcome to the Death Row and Executions channel. I'm Paco Rivera. You can also follow me on Facebook for more Death Row news and execution updates. There will be a link to my Facebook in the description below. Little Cassandra Lynn Williamson, known to everyone as Casey, was born on Thanksgiving Day in 1995. By the year 2002, Casey was 6 years old and attending kindergarten at Valley Park Elementary School in Missouri. She was the second oldest of four siblings. Her older sister, Chelsea, was 12. Elizabeth was 4, and her little brother Ernie, named after his father, was 2 years old. Casey was said to have a big, bright smile. At just 6 years old, she enjoyed attending a Protestant church near her home. She also enjoyed riding her bicycle and singing, and she was a huge fan of Britney Spears. Casey was the daughter of Ernie and Angela Williamson. Casey's family and friends would never see her graduate from any school. There would be no family trips with Casey to the beach or an amusement park or theaters to see her favorite movie or proms or marriage or seeing Casey have her own children. Because that year of 2002, a monster decided to end her life when she was still just 6 years old. Earlier that year, Casey's parents, Ernie and Angela, had separated. Angela, known more as Angie, then takes her four children to live with her father, the kid's grandfather, Jim Weidman, on Benton Street in Valley Park, Missouri. Almost directly across the street from Mr. Weidman's home lived Eddie Barrick with his girlfriend, Michelle Rem. That couple Eddie and Michelle, were also friends of Casey's parents, Ernie and Angie. And not long after Angie moved into her father's house with the kids, Eddie and Michelle agreed to rent a room to Casey's father, Ernie, on the second floor of their house across the street so that he can be near his children. On Wednesday, July 24th, 2002, although separated from their marriage, Ernie and Angie were spending some time together on the front porch of Angie's father's house on Benton Street when they see an old acquaintance coming up the road. It was 24-year-old Johnny Johnson, who Ernie and Angie have known since they were all children. They had all gone to school together. The three of them talked for a while, and then Johnny leaves. Later that evening, Angie takes the children across the street to Eddie and Michelle's house so that the kids can spend the night with their dad. And when they went inside, Johnny Johnson was also there. As it turns out, Johnson was also a friend of Michelle's boyfriend, Eddie. Sometime later, Angie took the children up to Ernie's room on the second floor to spend the night. And even though Ernie and Angie are separated from their marriage, she ends up staying there all night too. Early the following morning, now Thursday, July 25th, Angie wakes up and her daughter Casey is not in the room. She goes downstairs and finds Johnny Johnson and Casey sitting on opposite ends of the couch watching television. Johnson had apparently slept on the couch overnight. Angie asks Johnny Johnson if Casey had awoken him, and he told her, no, she's fine, that she wasn't bothering him. Later that day in the evening, everyone was eating food from the grill at Eddie and Michelle's home when they saw Johnny Johnson coming up the road again, and they invited him to eat as well. And he ended up staying the night again on the couch. Angie and the children also stayed again that night up on the second floor with Ernie. At about 6:30 in the morning, now Friday, July 26th, the alarm goes off for Ernie to get ready for work. Casey tells her father that she's hungry. He tells her to let him finish up getting ready in the bathroom, and he will take her across the street to her grandfather's house to find her some food. Ernie then went to the bathroom located downstairs on the first floor. He walked past the couch where he saw Johnny Johnson asleep on it. Ernie later said that he was in the bathroom for no more than about 15 minutes. He came out and Johnny Johnson was no longer on the couch. He was gone. Ernie then went upstairs to get his daughter Casey, but she was also gone. He wakes up his wife Angie to let her know that Casey was gone. They wondered if, since Casey had said she was hungry, maybe Johnny Johnson took her to a nearby store to get her something to eat. Ernie went to the store. They were never there. He returned quickly and went to his father-in-law's house across the street to see if Casey went in there on her own. Mr. Weidman said that his granddaughter did not enter the house. That's when they called 911.
Have you been injured in an auto accident? Look at this direct deposit of $127,000. If you're looking to get compensated for an accident you were involved in, I want you to listen closely. Now, before you think that your accident doesn't qualify for compensation.
Because Casey and Johnny Johnson had both vanished from the at about the same time, it was presumed that they left together, and police were looking for both of them. Police began a search for Casey, and the families split up and began searching as well. Many from around the community learned of the disappearance and also volunteered to join in on the search. A witness named Lewis Barnhart learned of the incident and told police that he saw a man with a little girl walking along St. Louis Avenue and 6th Street earlier that morning, carrying a little girl on his back, piggyback. The little girl fit a description of Casey, and his description of the man fit that of Johnny Johnson. Casey's older sister, Chelsea, and a friend named Angel both went looking around on their bicycles, and Angel spotted Johnny Johnson walking back toward Benton Street, where everyone lived. Angel told Johnny that they were looking for Casey, and she asked him, "Where is Casey?" Johnson told her that he doesn't know. Angel then quickly finds a police officer and provides Johnny Johnson's location, since she knew that they were also looking for him. Police pick up Johnson, and they find him completely drenched, as if he had gone swimming with all his clothes on. He is taken to the police station for questioning. At that time, they also bring in the witness, Lewis Barnhart, who positively identifies Johnson as the man he'd seen carrying Casey on his back, piggyback, earlier that morning. Johnny Johnson finally admitted that he had taken Casey to the old abandoned glass factory in Valley Park, but his story about what happened there changed several times during questioning. At first saying that it was an accident, that he and Casey were trying to climb over a rock wall and that she slipped and fell and a rock became dislodged and hit her on the head, killing her. He said he then panicked and buried her. But when police arrived at the old glass factory and found Casey's body buried under rocks, leaves, and tree branches, it was obvious to them that Casey did not die in the manner that Johnson was saying. Now, most of what happened that morning comes from Johnny Johnson's final confession to police. So we may never really know the exact truth of what occurred or the accuracy of that confession. But according to Johnson, he woke up on the couch at Eddie and Michelle's home, and Casey was standing near the couch. She was wearing her child's nightgown and she was barefoot. Johnson gave her the impression that he was about to leave, and Casey asked him, "Where are you going?" Johnson told her that he was going to hang out for a while at the old glass factory and that it's a great place to play games and have fun, and if she wanted to come along. And she agreed. Johnson said that as they were walking along rough ground up the road, Casey complained that her feet were hurting. Remember, she was still barefoot. And she agreed to ride on his back, piggyback. They arrived at the old glass factory and make their way over a rock wall into a secluded area, kind of a pit located there. Johnson then stood in front of Casey and asked her if she wanted to see his private part, and she said no, but he removed his shorts anyway. He then told her to remove her panties so that he can see hers, but she refused. Johnson said that he then picked up a brick and hit her on the head several times, injuring her. He then ripped off her panties and threw her to the ground and got on top of her. But he says that he was unable to obtain an erection because Casey was, in his words, freaking out. She was kicking and screaming and trying desperately to crawl away. He said he began striking her in the head several more times with a brick as Casey was repeatedly saying, "I'm sorry, I'm sorry." Johnson then picked up what has been described as a basketball-sized boulder and brought it down on her head, killing her. He then buried her under rocks, leaves, and tree branches. Johnson then went to the nearby Merrimack River to wash off blood on his body. It was not long after that that he was picked up by police. Ernie and Angie Williamson and the neighbors from across the street, Eddie and Michelle, even knowing that Johnny Johnson had used drugs, had some legal troubles, and was somewhat of a drifter who sometimes crashed on the couch of people's homes, never saw him as a threat of any kind and would never suspect that he would harm a child. This is what they have said. He appeared mild-mannered and harmless, and they never thought, not even a bit, that he was capable of doing what he had done. I came across several documentaries and podcasts regarding this case while I was researching it. I noticed that most of the documentaries and podcasts had spent a lot of time discussing Johnny Johnson's upbringing, how he had a very hard life, was consuming drugs, and how he was suffering from schizophrenia. There was a lot of talk about Johnny Johnson's mental illness, depression, and suicide attempts over the years. The fact is that Johnson was not insane, not legally anyway. He knew exactly what he was doing. He knew it was wrong. And he tried to hide his actions from being discovered. This is something that a legally insane person would not do. They wouldn't know that they have done anything wrong. Casey's older sister, Chelsea, joined Casey in heaven on March 12, 2015, at just 24 years of age, when she passed away on her third day in the hospital after an infection from pneumonia caused multi-organ failure. Please remember to subscribe for more Death Row and upcoming execution stories. Remember that you can also follow me on Facebook for more Death Row news, execution updates, and more. There will be a link to my Facebook in the description below. I'm Paco Rivera.
Good afternoon. Welcome to another spontaneous broadcast of what we call the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. I am the Mighty One, the host, the gatekeeper of this program, known here on social media. Wherever you may find me, I am known as the Mighty. Angel Snub 97, I'm your brother and hopefully your friend, Angel Snub 97. Talik even Ra, rather. Woo! Man. Am I lucky? During my brief lifetime in this world, I have met celebrities. I have met certain stars. I've met certain, a few popular figures, entertainers, activists in my lifetime. And I guess that's cool. They're just people that we know because of their work. They sing, they dance, their activism or whatever. Then there are those who gain their fame, their celebrity, because of a heinous crime. Many of us in our lifetime, we will hear of murder, but we will never know a murderer, an actual murderer. We will hear about it, and we will see it on TV, and we might even go to the trial. We might sit in the audience but to actually know a person that took life, wow, actually know two killers. Anthony Mylon Ross, as you know, those who follow this broadcast, you know, Anthony Mylon Ross was a fella who got me caught up in the criminal justice system. And then a few years later, he murdered his whole family. He killed his wife and two children. But I'm the crazy one. We will talk about that in this broadcast. I'm the crazy one, but the one they chose to protect, the one who's supposed to be a victim, is now facing life in prison, or like this fella, death row. I know two murderers, two killers. I was hoping, I did not see the full short video. I thought that maybe this particular guy would have talked about the trial and the execution. He just basically was talking about that there's a trial date and the reason why. He didn't go into detail. But I'm very sure none of those documentaries is like hands-on experience. Because I know these killers personally. And nothing to brag about, but unfortunately for me, I know these killers, these murderers. Unfortunate for me, I was locked up with people that were murderers and rapists and pedophiles and whatever you can name, I was locked up with them. It just so happened some of these folks become not famous, but infamous. So I want to tell you my experience with this killer, Johnny Johnson. And I want to speak about this. I was dialoguing with our brother, Soul Brother 85, Deacon of Reality. And he suggested I should talk about this because I know with this man who just made this short video, he couldn't possibly know because I was locked up with this guy. I live with this child killer. I'm trying to get my thoughts together here because this bothers me. And I'm so happy that I'm not blackity black, black, all that pro-black dumb stuff. While this man was talking about what happened to this little girl, all I could see was a little girl. I ain't nothing but a white girl. Look what they did to black people. What that little girl had to do with black people? She's 6 years old, you pieces of trash. We should never allow an injustice to us mess up our mind where we become just as crazy as those who commit atrocity. This is one of the problems that I have with the blackity black crap. Because it takes your humanity away. But at the same time, you will talk about justice. But you think just like the one who is not just. And you become a racist just like they are. It's reverse racism, except they can practice theirs and you can't practice yours, because you would do the same thing. How could you listen to this story about this baby being murdered? Attempted rape. And you don't feel nothing because you pretend that you're so disgusted with what the white man done. But every day you're spending that white man's money. Every day your happy ass is on the white man's social media. Every day you're eating his food. Every day you're buying his gas. Every day you're using his electricity with your hypocrite ass. But you're so disgusted that white man do this. And then if something happened to your baby, you want the white man, FBI, CIA, the local authorities, you want all them to go find your child. But you have no empathy. You don't feel nothing for this baby that don't have nothing to do with none of this stuff. An innocent person. It goes to show how insane we have become. I don't want to be no part of that. Senseless, unjustified hatred for no reason. Y'all would take blood before you die. But you don't like white folks. You'll take the white blood. And you will let that white fireman take you out your house when your house is on fire. Or get you out of a car accident and use their jaws of life to take you out of a car accident. Y'all so damn fake. If you hate, then hate for real. And Caucasians do the same stuff. I don't like black people. But they will eat your food before they starve. They will take your blood. They will go into your arms before they burn up in a house. We've allowed racism to make us so damn sick. And I don't want no part of that. All I saw and I hear is this child, an innocent child, just like your children that you spit out and really don't give a damn about. Because if you gave a damn about them, you'd be putting them in a position. So, since you hate the white man so much, so they don't have to even be around white folks like that. You're doing absolutely nothing. Running your mouth and talking. That's all. And if you want to be part of that foolishness, that's your business. But as soon as I hear you get that white man's blood and you spending his money every day, talk about generational wealth. You don't give no value to a dollar. The white man is giving value to that dollar. You don't have no money. You don't have no gold and silver. You don't have nothing. Everything about you comes from them. And you find them disgusting. But you take their money and their dollar. Bunch of clowns. You claim you love black folks. I'm black, that's what you say. But you got a problem with me. You got problems with those who don't go for your bull crap. If I love you for whatever you are and whoever you are, because I love. A person that really love apples. They love the Granny Smith, the Macintosh, or whatever. They love apples, all the apples. If you love my people, I love black people, I love the people, I love black folk. But when they disagree with you, They don't support your crap that you think that you want to do that continues to fail. Time, not Angel Snuff Number 7, time has shown that it's a failure. Then you start calling them these names that you got from the white man. Coon, that's not your word. Coon, Sambo, Uncle Tom, all that belongs to the Peckerwood. All that belongs to them. But you hate them so much, but you use their words. And if you want to be part of that foolishness, that's your business. We want to call this a eulogy. A eulogy to the end of this trash that should have been dead long time ago. But we know how the justice system is. 20 years after the murder of this child. But your day, next month, you're going to be able to meet in person the Grim Reaper. And the Christians say, and a lot of these spiritual folks, matter of fact, why don't you, Johnny Johnson, why don't you just astral project out your body? And I would like to invite Johnny Johnson to the Realities Temple on Earth after he astral project out his body. Or some of you that claim that you can astral project, go get Johnny Johnson, bring him to the Realities Temple on Earth so that we can interview him. More dumbass stuff we believe. We love to believe in dumbass things. Dumb crap. So I want to tell you about my experience with this killer, this demon, Johnny Johnson. So Johnny Johnson, and it was another young guy that came into the mental facility. The thing about the mental facility is there are no secrets. Because you know black folks gonna talk. And the majority of the staff is soul brothers and sisters. Black folks gonna talk. They can't help it. They gonna talk. So you can come into a place like that. All your information is supposed to be under HIPAA law. It guarantees your privacy. Nobody would ever know that you was in that mental facility. That's nobody's business. You are protected. When you come to the Department of Mental Health, it's like going to the doctor. It's under HIPAA. It's private. The only reason why you know anything about me is because I told you. You cannot go online. You cannot go nowhere and find documentation about me during my time in the nut house. I told you because I'm not ashamed. I told you because I'm bringing a story of injustice. And I'm not ashamed. I'm not the only black man. I'm not the only soul brother. I'm not the only person of color that have been unjustly incarcerated. And I'm telling my story. It just so happened that I was locked up in a mental institution instead of a regular prison. Johnny Johnson know how it feels to be in jail, in prison, and in the mental institution. He knows how to, Johnny Johnson know about it all. He has a criminal record. I don't have a criminal record. To have a criminal record means you have a history of criminal behavior, which Johnny Johnson had. Johnny Johnson was facing 7 years. He should have been in prison. They sent him to the mental institution. He should have been in prison. He was facing 7 years. He has a criminal record, but we live in a racist society. Here I am, no criminal record. Here I am, no violence associated with me. We gonna do everything we can to keep you locked up. Here's a sucker who's mentally ill. Here's a sucker with a criminal record. We're not gonna give him the 7 years. We're gonna be slick, send him to the mental institution, and he's gonna stay there for a few months, and we're gonna release him when he should have been in prison. Our brother Craig is in the audience, and he has a familiarity with the criminal justice system. He knows what I'm talking about. And if brother Talib was here, he would tell you he has experience also with this criminal justice system. Also, brother Khalil. So, you know, black men in the criminal justice system, some of you believe that, oh, that can't happen to me. You don't know what you might get caught up in life. So don't say, oh, that won't happen to me. That can't happen to me. You don't know what might come down the line and you get caught up. You can also get set up. There were people in that mental institution, their family put them in there so they can get their money. Huh? So if you got a little money, you don't know what your family might do. Or you have people that just don't like you. And you get caught up in the mental health system. So don't say, oh, that can't happen to me. You don't know what might happen to you in life. I never thought that I would have I didn't think about it. I know it's possible, but I didn't think that I could get a cancer diagnosis. I got it. We don't know what might happen to us. You can just walk out your house and get hit by a car. You can walk out your house and one of the squirrels in your neighborhood jump off the roof, scratch you, and you get rabies. And you have to take all these rabies shots. We don't know what might happen. Stop talking about, oh, that can't happen to me. Oh, that won't happen. Oh, you don't know what might happen to you in life. We don't know. We are, as they say in religion, we're blessed if we can run the gauntlet and avoid some of this stuff. Look, some of y'all brothers, you're handsome, right? Oh, you know you're handsome. You go to the gym, you lift those weights and you run. And some of y'all have flowing hair. It goes in the breeze while you're running, be jumping. Turn some women on. I'm not talking about no particular people. And so you get hooked up with one of these women, and then you don't want to be with her no more. And she said, I don't think so. You come out your house, she's there. Go to your job, she's there. Like, what the hell's up? What's up with her? We don't know. You don't know what you might have to deal with in life. And she said, she decides, well, if I can't have you, nobody will. So you go down to the store, get your little soda, and this stalker woman shoots you in the face. We don't know what's going to happen to us in life. So we need to get that out of our mind. Oh, that can't happen to me. That won't happen to me. Do you think that Michael Jackson or Whitney Houston or Prince, do you think any of these people, could they imagine how they was going to die? They didn't have no idea. Had no idea. So Johnny Johnson is in the mental institution. There's no secrets. Those people are going to talk. These nurses and folks got the records and they're going to talk. And so what we found out about Johnny Johnson, he had a long criminal record and he was facing 7 years and they brought him toward the crazy house. That's how they get a lot of these people off. Now you have some of these horrendous cases like, what's his name? That Dylan Roof guy. He suffered mentally ill, whatever. That's too horrific. But how they save a lot of white guys from going to prison, you mentally ill, send you to the crazy house, spend a few months, maybe a few years, so the public, because if it's a highly profile case, they just can't let you go. They let you go in the crazy house for a few years, and you won't even know that they released these people. They only have to, by law, they only have to tell the family. And a lot of times, the family don't give a damn no more. They're not tripping off of it. So, there was another young guy that came into the mental institution also. Little black guy. So, little soul brother. He don't want to tell people why he's there. Yo, why are you here? This is another thing. When you get locked up, most people will tell you why they got locked up. No shame in the game. I raped me 3 women. You know, no big deal. They should have, you know, they should have did what that. They should have did what I asked them to do. I shot a cop. I shot 2 gang members. I stole a diamond. Most people, when they get locked up, they come in and they will tell you. The people that won't tell what they was charged with, chances are, it's pedophilia. It's got something to do with them being a pedophile. And even in the mental institution, when you are a pedophile, folks don't look at you too good. A pedophile. So it comes to find out that this young guy, he's a pedophile. Molesting one of his cousins or something like that. Sticking his finger up the cousin's dress. That's what he was accused of. I'm not going to tell you. And there was a white guy too. He was accused of molesting his niece. That's none of your business. When they tell you it's none of your business, they are pedophiles. So we have little Johnny Johnson in the nut house. And you wouldn't think that Johnny Johnson, like the guy said in the short video, you wouldn't think that Johnny Johnson would in the future become a child killer. He's a pedophile. You would not think that. Johnny Johnson was running around. This is a killer. Johnny Johnson was running around, always drawing pictures of flowers and birds, especially flowers. I just love flowers. He never raised his voice. He always talked very low. I love flowers. Look at the flowers. And the and the doctors, you know, they went for the old okie doke. They went for the old okie doke. He would draw these flowers like he's a Mr. Goody Two Shoe. He draws flowers and he would talk about his grandma. I'm drawing the flower. While he's drawing the flower, he's talking about his grandma. I miss my grandma. I love my grandma. You want a flower? I'm looking at this guy. I'm like, you got to be serious. You can't be serious. Now, Johnny, while he was in the nut house, there was a guy, a brother, Joe Cunningham. And Joe Cunningham was a freak. He was a bisexual, transsexual, whatever the hell you want to call it. Joe Cunningham do it all. And when these two young guys came, Joe Cunningham was like, damn, that look good. Now, myself and Joe, we got along. Because Joe know I kick his ass. You ain't gonna mess with the kid. Joe was telling me, man, that's some, what you telling me that for? I don't want to hear that homosexual crap. Tell me how good these young boys' booty look. Joe Cunningham was a booty man. He probably deceased now. Joe Cunningham had a criminal record too. And Joe Cunningham thought that the government put a tracker or something in his ear. And you know something? See, this is the thing about when people call you crazy. When people call you crazy and you say certain things, you ignore. But you know, the more Joe Cunningham talked, I started to believe maybe some government did put something in his ear. He would always be scratching his ear, you know, like he wanted to try to get in his head and pull it out. And I asked the people, why don't y'all x-ray his head so we could see if this, he's crazy, blah, blah. They would never, of course they wouldn't do it. But see, we know what these people would do. And of course the most famous act they have ever done to us, one of the most experimental things they done to us was what they called the Tuskegee experiment. A lot of us don't like to go to the doctor because of the Tuskegee experiment and other things they have done to us in this country. Not necessarily. Now, some of us don't want to go to the doctor because we scared of needles. We don't want to hear bad news. I got cancer or whatever. But a lot of us, we don't like doctors because of those things. And the more Joe talked about it, and he said that he grew up in foster care or whatever. And he said when he was a child, they put him to sleep and he felt good. But then when he woke up, he said there was a bump or something on his ear. And you want to know something? I hear the story. I laughed at first. But the more he told the story, and I remember, and I know about how they have done experiments on us in this country, it's a possibility that he was one of the first people that was microchip and didn't know it. As you know, they do microchip. Some of these companies that we work for, they require that you get microchip instead of that identification card or whatever they give you. And you know, whatever the microchip is, you just put it up to the scanner and it'll let you in and out of the building, things of this nature. The microchip, we don't know about the technology of the microchip. The microchip could also be used possibly for mind control. It probably hasn't advanced to the point where they can actually take over your mind, but that microchip can give suggestions. And I've heard that and I laughed about it. But the more you think about it, it's possible. It's possible because this is the kind of country that we're dealing with. We're dealing with deceivers. We're dealing with manipulators. We're dealing with folks that like to control others. So there's a possibility. And of course, Joe Cunningham is in the crazy house. Who's going to believe him? But one thing you can believe is Joe Cunningham, microchip or not, Joe Cunningham wanted some boo-boo with the doo-doo. And Johnny Johnson was scared of that man. And Joe Cunningham was doing everything he could to try to catch him in the bathroom or whatever. I'm like, wow, this is incredible. I said, Joe, why you like that, bro? And he had a religious answer. Joe said, that's what God made it for. What? Joe told me, Joe said that God said, anybody that has a penis, any hole you want to put your penis in, you can do it. It don't have to be a woman. It could be a tree. If the tree got a hole in it, you can put your penis in it. You know, he said a hole is a hole. And he liked that hole. So for the safety of these young guys, they moved these young guys to the women's pod where the women was at to protect these guys from both of these young guys were scared of Joe. Because Joe don't care. Booty is booty, black or white. He didn't care that Johnny Johnson was a white guy. He didn't care if the other guy was black. He didn't care. A hole is a hole when it came to Joe Cunningham. Parental discretion is advised, I guess. Maybe he was being manipulated by that microchip in his ear. I don't know. Joe was a funny guy. Hey, I know one day we was playing what's that game? Bidwiz, Spades, or one of those games. And like you know, I'm a very competitive person. I like to win. And we don't have nothing else to do in the nut house except play cards. I play basketball. We do that all the time. Only thing you can do is get better. So I'm playing these cards. I wasn't a card player until I got locked up. You learn how to play cards. Another game we love to play is dominoes. You know, all these different games. You don't have, you locked up. What else you have to do? So I got good at these things. And I like to win. I was winning on the basketball court and I was winning on that card table. And Joe Cunningham kept calling me a cheat. You one cheating black nigga. You cheat. You know you cheat. I said, no, Joe, I'm just good like that. And so I kept winning. And Joe couldn't take it no more. And he stood up. I'm sick of you cheating like this. I'm gonna kick your ass. I'm like, hey, Joe, I wouldn't advise that, bro. You don't scare me. Joe's bigger than I am. But he's a little old. And he's slower. He's not going to do nothing. Anyway, he's going to try because Joe is really, really angry by this point. I'm kicking your ass. And so Joe gets so angry, get ready to fight. You know how it is when some of y'all get ready to fight. You want to take your shirt off. You know, you buff up. Come on with it. You know, you got to get ready. You know, warm up. Joe went into his mouth and took his dentures out and threw them on the table. Come on, nigga. Come on with it. I didn't know Joe's teeth was fake. All that was denture. Man, come on with it, nigga. Everybody started laughing. Like, what the hell is this? Because we thought that was Joe's real teeth. We didn't know he had denture. And everybody busts out laughing. And he, come on with it, nigga. Come on, you talking all that? Yeah, come on with it. What the hell? And so we all laughing. And even Joe started laughing. You know, because I mean, you took your, I mean, what's the purpose of taking your teeth? Now, I eventually probably would have knocked his teeth out anyway, but you know, get Joe, throw his teeth on. What was the purpose of that? You know, throw your teeth on the table. And that was funny. That was a funny moment. All of us laughed. Even Joe had to laugh. But Joe wanted that booty. He, you know, when it's all said and done, Joe mind was always trying to get to them young boy. Here's a future killer scared of this black guy in the nut house. So Johnny Johnson put on this front. He drawing flowers. I miss my grandma. I miss my grandma. Now that won't work for us. If I started drawing flowers and talking about I miss my grandma, that wouldn't work for black folks in the nut house. drawing flowers and birds talking about I miss my grandma. That's not gonna work for us. So y'all don't try it, okay? Don't try it. It only work with white boys in the nut house. But it only work. But it's, you know, so he's putting on this front. He never gets angry because they use anger against you. He was a happy-go-lucky guy as long as he was there. Now, usually, if you was black, even though they send you to the nut house, you go from the nut house, and chances are, you go to prison. You go from the nut house. And you go to jail, you go to prison. White guys go free. So Johnny Johnson packed up his little corny stuff and they released him. Bye, everybody. He had his little bag and still had some of his drawings, the little pictures. Flowers, and he was still talking about that grandma stuff. Again, we're not privileged to private information, but those staff told us that he's supposed to go to his grandma house because he loved his grandma. And so he said, I'm getting, you know, he going to his grandma house. So the staff told us he going to his grandma house. And we like, well, yeah, okay, it's cool. That's what he said. He misses his grandma. He want to go to his grandma. He's supposed to go to his grandma house. As you know, and as we found out, flower drawing, bird drawing, I love my grandma, Johnny Johnson, did not go to his grandma house. And even though he's free, he's free under what they call conditional release, like probation or whatever. And he's supposed to be with his grandmother at his grandma's house. He didn't. He started roaming the streets of Valley Park, Missouri. He's supposed to be at his grandma's house. And we know the rest of the story. We know how he got together with some ex-schoolmates or whatever, blah, blah, blah. And the end result, he killed this little girl. So next month, I wonder if he was drawing any flowers and birds and talking about he missed his grandma in prison. In Bon Terre. How many birds, Johnny Johnson, how many flowers you gonna draw next month, Johnny Johnson? I have no sympathy, no sorrow for a child killer. You're a grown man. And you could, he's so, he's so such a loser. He couldn't even handle the little girl. So you know he couldn't handle a woman or a teenager. He couldn't handle a six-year-old. And then get frustrated and bust her head open with a rock. There are those who are against the death penalty. And I understand why we would be against the death penalty, because there are those who are innocent and they have executed innocent people. We know this. In this case, there's no innocent. Oh, he was mentally ill. No, he wasn't. Because if he was mentally ill, they would have sent him right back to the nut house. They sent him to prison. And you can get treatment for your mental illness in prison. I guarantee you he was not treated for no mental illness while he was in prison. The games people play. No, he was just a pitiful, poor piece of trash, an idiot. And this is what ends up happening. Now we blame Johnny Johnson. But I also blame the parents. You got a stranger in your house with your children, and you're not watching the stranger. You don't know this guy. I didn't think he would do that. Maybe, maybe not. The job of the parent is to protect that child, your children. Just like a lot of us get bit by dogs. I didn't think Scruffy would do that. Shout out to Scruffy. That's my favorite dog. I always talk about Scruffy. And then Scruffy bite the hell out of you. There's no guarantee that your dog won't turn on you and bite you. It happens all the time. Dogs have killed children because you trust that dog. The job of the parent is to protect that child. When you're not around, you don't leave that dog with that child. You don't leave no stranger with your children. And this little girl's parents failed as a parent, probably because they was drug users. Of course, they're not going to talk about that. Chances are they were drug users and alcoholics, because that's what Johnny Johnson was. And most people who drink attract other people that drink. People that smoke weed attract other people that smoke weed. And if you're a weed smoker and you're a damn drunk, how the hell are you going to keep an eye on your children? At least one of the parents is sober so they can watch the children. Mommy and daddy getting high. I've seen it. Mommy and daddy get high during the crack epidemic. You had wife and husband, girlfriend and boyfriend, high on crack. How the hell are they going to protect children? Who knows how many of these people have been molested as children? And sometimes the crack, sometimes the drugs, they molest their own children, these parents. So we come on social media and we wonder about the mental health of some of these people. Remember, many of these people were raised by children. Many of these people come from homes like that. and you think they normal. Some of these people on social media, you think they normal. You might think that you normal. You've been through the same thing yourself. Oh, I'm all right. I survived. But it still affect you. Especially, who was it? Monique. The comedian Monique. She was on Oprah Winfrey's show. She was molested by her brother. And she was on Oprah Winfrey's show with her brother sitting right next to her talking about it. Tyler Perry was molested. Oprah Winfrey was molested. And we look normal. But are they normal? These things that affect us. What if you are a man in prison and you get raped by men? I don't care. You can be Mr. Mike Tyson. You can't fight 30 men. And these 30 men say, we want that boo-boo. They hold you down and take your manhood. Some of these men are married. And they love men because they still hold on to that. That's part of their life now. What they used to call that, down low brothers. You think that just disappeared? Something happened. There's a reason why so many men are on social media with all these I hate the black woman videos and the black woman do this. There's a reason for it. That's not natural for a man to hate women the way they do. That's unnatural. I don't care what the woman done. Because nature call and you respond and you don't care. I seen a male lion. He was trying to get busy with this the lioness. And she scratched him all in the face and bit him up or whatever. And for some of you, the hell with that bee. I ain't got that male lion said, ain't nothing but a scratch. Ain't nothing but a scratch, baby. Ain't nothing but a scratch. You know. Because his nature is calling him to her. And eventually, she gonna give in because her nature responds to him. But something happened to these people in their life. They was molested, they was beaten. And sometimes it's not even by strangers. It's by the people we know. It's by friends and family. A lot of these murders that occur, a lot of it don't even happen by strangers. It's by people we know, friends and family. So we on social media and we believe the people that we're talking to, they're normal, whatever normal is. I don't know what the hell normal is. Because I understand living in the United States of America, the melting pot of sickness, the melting pot of insanity, everybody thinking this way, everybody thinking that way. It's a ball. What does the temptation say? Ball of confusion. Do-do-do-do-do. The ball of confusion. Do-do-do-do. It's a ball of confusion. It's all right to have a difference of opinion. It's all right to disagree. Look at the level, especially soul brothers and sisters, black men and women in this country. Look at the level of disagreement, division that we're on. Something is wrong. We're sick. And it's because of how we come up in this nation, because the country is sick. And you think that you're normal. I wonder if Oprah Winfrey, I wonder if Monique, I wonder if Tyler Perry, would they give their millions away if they could do it all again and not go through being molested? Because those of us like myself, we really don't understand how detrimental the hurt that people go through. We say a woman is raped. You ain't never been raped, so you're like, yeah, man, she just got raped. She had the wrong clothes on. I've never been raped. I can't even imagine somebody that I don't want. They just gonna take my body. Can't even imagine. And here we are when we talk about children that don't even know nothing about no sex. And you got a grown man. And nowadays, children watching all this stuff on television and cable. You're letting your children watch all this R-rated, X-rated garbage. And these children mimic. They don't know what they're doing. And they rape their own siblings. It's happening. These parents. So we talk about Johnny Johnson. You cannot let those parents off the hook. Where was the parents? You got a stranger in your house. Stranger going on down. What they doing? Sleep? And a stranger got your baby on his back, going down to a factory to hide because he know what he's getting ready to do and want to do. The child wants to play. And this is another thing. We don't give our baby because there's no... The purpose of men working and the woman stay home so she can guide and take care of those children properly. But these men, I'm the breadwinner. Negro, you just doing your part. She's at home. I'm so lucky that my mother was able to stay with us 24 hours a day. We never went to daycare and all that other stuff. My mother was always there. My mother was always there to protect us. She was always there. May she rest in peace. You have these children and you're not a parent. You're called a parent by default. You're called a wife by default. You're called a husband by default. You're called a man by default. A woman, just a bunch of savages running around. High on cocaine, a bunch of drunks. I'm a bisexual, trisexual, trilateral sexual, all kinds of freak. You just all messed up in the United States of America. So when you bring your babies into America, you bringing your babies into a predator state, all kinds of predators waiting on them. Hell, you got a lot of predators waiting on you, and we grown. But when you're grown, you're responsible for yourself. Those children are your responsibility. And the parents of Casey Williamson, they failed their child. So, even to the point, from all the news broadcasts I've seen, they don't even blame the prison system. They don't even blame the Department of Mental Health. The Department of Mental Health, who are supposed to be the experts on human behavior, they approved his release. He was not a danger to himself or others. But they have a whole many black people, soul brothers and sisters, locked up who are not dangerous, who were accused of lesser crimes than Johnny Johnson and was doing better, but they were danger to themselves and others. At this, now, about the same amount, the same time that this happened with Johnny Johnson, there was another white guy. I don't remember his name. If I see him, I think his name was Mike something. I forgot what his name was. Around the same time, they let out another white guy. He got a job at a Dairy Queen or some type of fast food restaurant. And it was closing time. It was just him and the young girl assistant manager, whatever. And he tried to rape her. She was able to get to her phone and get to a safe spot in the restaurant until the police got there. And both of these guys committed their crimes less than 3 months after they was released. It's not like 2 years went by, 3 years went by. Immediately, as soon as they let these guys go, they committed a crime. An attempted rape and the murder of a six-year-old child. Immediately. And nobody blames the Department of Mental Health, the experts on human behavior. Nobody said nothing. Nobody said nothing to the court system. But they, in the city of St. Louis, they was really gung-ho. They wanted to get rid of, and we talked about Kim Gardner. Kim Gardner was actually, she's a prosecutor. She was actually helping black men get out of prison. She was doing things for the black community. We know why they went after Kim Gardner. I mean, they went on her hard. But we don't have no power. We don't have no influence. So the only thing we can do is just sit back and watch them stone her to death. That little marching that we do, leave Kim Gardner alone. Leave Kim, that don't mean nothing. The attorney general, racist. The state of Missouri just racist. There was a time a few years ago, I believe it was the NAACP, sent out a memo to black people traveling, hey, be careful when you go through the state of Missouri. Missouri was a slave state. It's still a slave state. You will see a big difference. The state of Illinois and Iowa, the surrounding state, you will see a big difference between Missouri and these other states if you're black going through those states. So Kim Gardner was helping black folks, and they knew it. That sister, we can't have that. Not in our slave state. Governor, what's his name? Governor Mike Parsons and that attorney general. You can look at them and see how racist they are. And here we are, we don't care. St. Louis City is at least 80% black, whatever. They even have a black mayor, female mayor, Tashara Jones. And she sided, you know, doing a bad, you know, she sided with them. They might come after me next. We run our mouth and talk about, and I watch these these black pro YouTube channels or whatever. And we talked about this before. We whimper. We puff our chest out. We puff our chest out and put on this show or whatever. It ain't gonna do nothing. So what's the sense of doing it? When I was locked up, I puffed my chest out. You a devil. You the children of Adolf Hitler. I run my mouth. It made me feel good. And when it's all said and done, I was still locked up. So what? These people only respect violence, or they respect the pen if you know how to use it. I know they respect the pen because I used the pen. And I saw them shiver and I saw them shake. Because you're using their own law against them. Just like you're able to take the gun from a police officer and shoot him with his own gun. You see what happened with the Black Panthers. The Black Panthers had them going. They had to hurry up and start changing the law. And the Black Panthers should have stayed on that. It was working, but they got caught up in all the blackity black, all that dumb stuff. Keep making them change the law. Run it down. I wore those people out. I was constantly filing stuff against them, using their own garbage. I could show us how to do some stuff from your computer. You don't even have to leave our house. We're listening to all this blackity black. This is not the 1960s. This is not the 1950s. All that outdated stuff. You don't need to do all that. You just need the unity and move as one. But again, we're sick. And there's a reason behind the sickness. Just the fact that we come from a slave background. Many of us will say, well, we need to stop using slavery as an excuse. Yes and no. Because this slavery, this condition lasted for hundreds of years. It did not last for a few minutes, a few days. This was a lifestyle for over 300 years. And I forgot what the technical term is, but this condition has even become part of our DNA. That's how bad it is. That's not an excuse. It's a reason why we messed up and we don't recognize. Even the ones that claim they know still act stupid, insane. Because you know, but you, what can you do about it? Knowing you have cancer, what the hell can you do about it? I know I got cancer. What am I going to do about it? You're not even trying. Because we have to have unity to do anything. And you don't want to do that. Because you caught up. Because you lied to yourself. I love my people. I do this for the people. No, you don't give a damn about the people. Because you're so selfish. If you don't get what you want, then you don't mind seeing the people go extinct. You don't mind the people suffering. So surrounded by a bunch of liars and hypocrites. They don't like me because you're not real. It's easy to unite. Here you are, adults. Y'all tripping on dumbass stuff. And you're not real. One of the examples is our brother Maurice Muhammad. Got to give him credit because he was real with his. You don't have to agree, but he was real with his. And the people that was with him claimed they was real too until he got too real. Let's sell all this stuff off. Mississippi, here we go. What? Man, you serious about that? Even me, when I ask people to do a little something, something, what? You want me to make a YouTube video? What? Make another channel for you? What? Maurice Muhammad said, let's go to Mississippi. I told him what was going to happen. As long as you just talking about it, they're going to clap their hands and stomp their feet. The reason why they support Brother Polite, the reason why they support most of these people out here, because you don't have to do nothing except Cash App sometimes. But when it comes to real work and you think you're really going to do something, these folks are comfortable. You mean go to Mississippi? I got to leave my good job and pick some tomatoes? I make $100,000 a year. You want me to go to Mississippi and milk a cow? No, Maurice, I love you, bro. Oh, no, I can't. No, bro, I can't. You don't want to sacrifice. You don't want. You pretend like you want to do something, and you don't. They laugh at the Mississippi campaign, not because it don't work. Not because it's a pipe dream. Because it's too much like work. It takes unity. You don't want to do that. It takes work and sacrifice. You don't want to do that. And why don't you just say, I don't want to? Because you're only lying to yourself. It's quite obvious you don't want to do a damn thing. If I thought folks were serious about doing something, I will sacrifice everything that I got. Every dime. I'll sleep in a sleeping bag on the ground because I want this. We want this for our children. We want this for ourselves. These people in this country that you're living in, they died. Nobody gave them this country. They fought the bears, they fought the mosquitoes, they fought the Native Americans, they fought, they sacrificed, and they died to get this. And you really believe because you march, because you complain, they gonna just give you something of substance. They'll give you some scraps. They're not gonna give you nothing of substance. The only way they're gonna give you something of substance because you're ready to fight for it. Because they know that you can punch them in their eye. They don't give you nothing. So by the time you get everything that you want, these people won't even want this country no more. They trying to go to the moon. They trying to go to Mars. You can have the earth. The black planet. The ultimate ghetto. All your water poison. The air is foul. Now you can have it turn into a ghetto. Just like how they did Barack Obama. When Barack Obama became president, this country was in a mess politically. It was just in ruins. It was just rotten.
hey, this is the time the Negro can be president. You know, have a black person be president. And then when Barack Obama became president, he took the blame for the problems that George Bush and other presidents caused. Now you can be president. Then, basically, Barack Obama sort of straightened everything else up. Now here come the white man. Now we can get this back again. That's how we roll here. That's how we roll. And we satisfied being used and exploited. Did you see during the time that Barack Obama was in the White House, how fast his hair turned gray? There's a saying that when you're under stress, your hair turns gray. Now, I know I saw Barack Obama, his hair was pretty black. And look at Barack Obama, hair is more gray than mine. If I let my hair grow out, I still have a lot of black in my hair. Barack Obama is pure, old looking gray. From stress, they said it's from stress. And he knows a lot of America's secrets and stuff. He was president of the United States. We don't want nothing. We really don't want nothing. I wish y'all would shut up and talk about liberty and freedom. You don't care about that stuff because liberty is not free. Freedom is not free. But you can pretend. Because I know some of us don't care because we waiting on Jesus. You know, God is coming to do something for us. But even in your scriptures, it says God don't help nobody that don't help themselves. If you take one step, God will take two steps for you. So what the hell you gonna get out the deal? The scriptures talk about you got to go to work. I'm paraphrasing. It says something about faith without works. You can have faith, but you gotta have work to go along with it. We just want to go to church, sing and dance. We just want to go to the mosque, sing and dance. We just want to go on YouTube, sing and dance, holler and skip for your favorite YouTube personality. And if that's what you want to do, cool. Y'all spitting out children. They gonna pay the price. Because you putting the curse on them. They gonna pay the heavy price. And even in your lifetime, and we've said this many times, and I'm gonna close this out, we've said many times on this platform, if the right thing happens in the world, you gonna get it. You're comfortable now talking all that. The black man loves the sun and the sun don't burn nobody up. Sun is good for black people. And your ass is at home under the air conditioning. It was a brother with a post like that talking about white people burned up by the sun and he's out there jogging and the sun is good to black people. Okay. The truth of the matter is the more melanin that you have in your, the more dark the pigment in your skin, the better you can handle the sunlight. But no life can handle direct sunlight. No life except plants, because they can't even move, so they have no choice. But there's no life, no mammal, nobody, nothing with blood gonna stay in the direct sunlight. You got to get out of direct sunlight. I watched the news over the week. Many black people have died. Sunstroke. I don't see no Pan-African pro-black folks out in the sun, out in 112 degree temperature. I thought the sun is so beautiful, so good for you. Get your ass out there and make you some vitamin D. And get a sunstroke. These people are in their house watching YouTube videos in central air. They're not out jogging and doing sunbathing out in the sun. But they live in these delusions, this fantasy world. We live in fairy tales, hallucinations, fantasy world. That's not real. Oh, the sun gonna burn white people up. These people conquered the desert. These people kick Africans in the ass. Ain't it hot over there? And they didn't have air conditioning. They went from Europe into Africa and kicked those people's ass, except the Ethiopians, I believe. They said they was the only nation that wasn't conquered by the white folk. And they over there now. These people are living in the desert. White folks right now are buying because it's cheap land and living in the desert. The sun not killing them. Where you getting this stuff from? Yeah, there's people waiting on the sun to kill all the white people. It's not going to happen. Because it's killing you too. They conquered the earth. They conquered the world. They conquered these deserts. The white folks been in the coldest of the cold, the hottest of the hot. What the hell are you talking about? Kick Africans ass first shot. You falling and can't get up. Took over a whole continent. And the Africans outnumbered them. 100-1 or whatever. And you talking about like they weak. These folks ain't weak. These folks will kick your ass. I know I was caught up with that playing basketball. White man can't jump. White man can't play no basketball. You're damn lie. So my head is full of that stuff. Went to play basketball, white guys versus the black guys. And we looking at each other, hey, white folks can't play no basketball. These white guys, them jumpers, they, whew, somebody done told me wrong. We get caught up in all these fairy tales. They might not play ball the way, but see, they might not be able to play basketball like you. You buying the basketball from them. You buying the rim, you buying the shoes from them. And the asphalt when you make your courts. They buy your talent. So what? You good at basketball? You don't control nothing. So what? You can dance. They pay you to dance. They pay you to sing. You're a good singer. I pay you. Because after I rule the world, I want to be entertained. Go ahead, Beyonce. Did you get your Beyonce ticket? I'm going to see En Vogue.
Never gonna get it.
And you hug and kiss on them. And talk about them behind their back. We know how it is. They don't care. Because they control everything. They don't give a damn because you sing and dance. They pay you to do that. Still a modern minstrel show. Who you think is the majority of the people buying Beyonce tickets? Black folk Who are the majority of people buying James Brown and Michael Jackson Prince tickets? Who was the majority? It wasn't us. It was them. Because they run everything, control everything. And they the ones making all the money. Beyonce on tour right now. And she's going to get paid. Those concert promoters, those venue promoters, those people making the money. So what she can sing? I don't have to sing and making ducats more than Beyonce. Michael Jackson Thriller album made over $1 billion. Michael got 40 million, maybe 50 million out the deal. Thriller made $1 billion. Michael only gets 50 million. Where the other money went to? But you laugh at Operation Exodus, Mississippi. You laugh. It's a pipe dream. But you don't have no power. You don't have no influence. You don't have nothing. So you are at the mercy of those who do. We might laugh. I'm going to say this. We laugh at a small dog. Now look at that little dog. He can't do nothing. We're more scared of the larger dog. But that little dog earned your respect when it turned around and bite the hell out of your ass. It might be a small bite, but see, the thing about a bully, the thing about arrogant people, they don't want to get hurt at all. That's how it is with bullies, arrogant people. They don't want to get hurt at all. So when the small dog turn around and bite you, the little dog earn respect, even though it's a small bite. Now you know how it feels to hurt. Now you know what pain is. We got to bring the pain. But what do they say? If you want some ass, you got to bring some ass to get some. You don't want to do nothing. You're not a fighter. You're a lover. You're a lover. That's your problem. You're a lover. And that's how we are. We love everybody. I even see it on the Facebook. We love it. It's all about love, love, love. Come here. Give me a hug. I love you. I love love. It's all about we. To them, not to ourselves, to them, to others. Our religion don't belong to us. We got it from other people, foreigners. That's not our stuff. We don't want nothing that we don't want nothing connected to, because we don't love you. We love everybody except us. How can you get angry at me when I say, if you want to believe in God, ask God to come to you and give you your own. What's wrong with that? Instead of these hand-me-downs from these foreigners, from ancient people that's been dead 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years ago. What's wrong with me saying, I want my own? Ask God, I want my own. I want a messenger. I want a messenger from Soul Sister, black woman. I want God to come to a black man. I don't want nothing from no Africans. I want nothing from no Indians. I want my own. What's wrong? Because you don't love yourself. You don't want your own. So the Mississippi campaign comes from us. Oh, I don't want that. Ain't no Hebrews connected to that. Ain't no Arabs connected to that. Ain't no Africans connected to that. Because you don't believe in yourself. You don't believe that you're smart enough, intelligent enough. You got to be connected to some sucker. Otherwise, you feel you can. You need somebody to hold your hand. And that's another thing. We don't want the responsibility. God, we want to put the responsibility on somebody else. Well, God gonna do it. Jesus gonna do it. Muhammad gonna do it. The space alien gonna do it. We don't want the responsibility because, like I said in earlier live streams, we're children, and we want somebody to cuddle us and hold our hand. But at the same time, you want to be treated as an adult. That's not how things go. But it's up to us, it's up to you. And I know why folks don't like Angel Snuff Nub 7, because we're too real. We're too real. Your condition is not going to change until you become an adult. Not an adult by default. I'm not going to call you an adult. I'm not going to call you a man or a woman or God or warrior till you earn it. And up to this point, you have not earned nothing. These people will give you the respect, whether they like it or not, when you earn it. They have no respect for you because as far as they're concerned, you're still a boy. And that's what they call you behind your back, because it's not politically correct to call you a boy in your face no more. Boy, girl, we have so many issues. We have so many things that we need to deal with. And until we deal with the reality of things, it's all downhill. And you put that burden on your children that you claim you love. But you are just like Casey Williams's parents. You're an unfit parent. And a stranger is in your house. Accept reality, my friend, is much easier. On that note, thank you so much for listening. Jot down your comments, all that kind of good stuff. It's always an honor that you would give us a few minutes, well, actually an hour or so of your time, to let us rant, let us vent. That's good therapy. I mean, that's good therapy to talk about things or whatever, but to continue to talk and there's no action, just complaining, that's a waste of time. So I got quiet. I shut my mouth and I began to concentrate on how can I change this condition. Now, once I began to do that, I began running my mouth again. But now I got backup. I can back up what I say. But we just talking and can't do nothing except look pitiful. And we should be tired of looking pitiful. Shout out to Sister Tangie and her family in California. Shout out to our people in London, England, Just Acting and The Resident. I would hope that one day, because of the time difference, I hope one day that they can catch a live stream live. I need to go see when we can try to time our live stream so our people in London, England can come in the chat room and enjoy the company of others who have accepted reality. It's not, as you can see, it's not many of us, because they can't handle it. Adults who can't handle reality. Shout out to those who are listening and those who will be listening to this broadcast later. Shout out to our Instagram and our Facebook.
listeners. Shout out, of course, to Marcus X. I saw him. I saw Brother Yanga in the chat room. Black Dynamite in the chat room. Mellow Cap and the Deacons of Reality, of course. And always appreciate. Thank you so for your support, whatever. I appreciate it. It's an honor. And you give me the strength to keep pushing this word. Because if we don't accept reality, we're done. It's as simple as that. All that fancy talk and all the wisdom and knowledge, all this stuff that we tripping off of, that don't mean nothing if you don't properly. The key word here is properly apply. The key word here is to, it's good to have all this knowledge, the appropriate knowledge. And grow up, we trip on, we're supposed to be adults, we trip on dumb stuff. I don't mess with Angel, he make me mad. Dumb stuff. What you mad at Angel? What you angry at Angel Snubnub 7 for? Cause I asked you to share a video. That's why. Something simple as that. Not gonna make it, people. I understand all stories don't have happy endings. I don't see really at this point in time a happy ending for the so-called Negro because we're too caught up in foolishness. We're too much like children. And we're selfish. Very selfish. And we're cowards. We're cowards. We have no faith in ourselves. So we talk about others, what they've done, because we won't do it for ourselves. We talk about what the Black Panthers did and what they did in the past, whatever. What about what you do? What are the future generations going to say about what you did? Absolutely nothing. What did they do in 2023? They made a whole lot of YouTube videos. They was on Instagram. They was on Facebook. And I opened up a business. We love that. I opened up a business. I got $100,000 a year. Don't have no power. Have no resources. Don't have no influence. Still don't have nothing. That's good. I'm happy for you and your family. That does not help 40 million plus in this country because you got a business make 100 grand. How does that help me? Speaking of that, I'm going to get out of here. I'm going to play the lottery. I think the drawing is Monday or Tuesday or whatever. I'm playing the lottery. I'm going to try to win this money. Not for me. So I can push this program, Operation Exodus Mississippi Campaign. And I would encourage you to play the lottery too. Maybe you might win and maybe you might help. Since you got all this money now, maybe you would help. But a lot of us, we talk a bunch of crap. I ain't giving no money to no Operation Exodus Mississippi campaign. What you gonna do with all that money you just won? I'm going to Disneyland. I'm gonna go see En Vogue. We so fake. I'm out of here, y'all. Thank you for listening. John Donnie comes, all that kind of good stuff. And as our brother Don Cornelius used to always, as our brother Don Cornelius, Don Cornelius used to always say, as important, I wish us love, peace, and soul.